beautiful day, beautiful crowd, a great long weekend for family and fellowship and whatnot. Glad to be here this morning. Y'all know that David did a great job last week. A little bit too good, I'm afraid. That will be his last time to preach here. I cannot take any more Sundays off now, so y'all are stuck with me. But no, I appreciate it. It was a great, great day last week all the way around. Been a busy week, Camp Ark this week, early in the week, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. And kids had a ball. The adults had a ball. A lot of hard work went into that, thanks to Allie and all of her crew and volunteers that made that work out to be such a special time. Just something new, you know. We've never done it before, and she stepped out, and I think it worked out really, really well. Tuesday, 4th of July. This is our, I don't know how many annual holiday community cookout. Probably five or six, I think. We started this, and it's gotten a little bigger and a little better every year. Last year, we added live music, and we're going to expound upon that this year even. So we'll have food at 6, live music starting about 6:30, maybe a little bit later. Our Unity Chorus is going to do some songs that you're going to be blown away by. Garrett and Brianna are going to do a set, which is going to be phenomenal as always. Fireworks about 9 o'clock. So if you don't have a better place to view fire, and you don't have a better place, you can't see them any better from anywhere, except maybe the Pressel's backyard. They may have us on that one. But nonetheless, it's going to be a good time. Come and serve. We are having a time of everybody can serve, do something, and we're going to have an orientation meeting after church this morning, after Sunday school, for those who want to volunteer. So here we go. Ain't she cute? Let me see what I got here. There we go. That's Molly Claire, John. That's my granddaughter, for those who haven't figured that out yet. And she's a little bit over 3 months old. And we already know that she's the most beautiful and most intelligent baby that's ever been born. Just so happens that she takes after her grandfather in many ways. But here's the interesting thing that I've been thinking about. They were here for a couple weeks and just holding her, laying on the floor, watching her and things. It's pretty awesome. But she can't do a single thing for herself. She's quite selfish. Quite selfish. She gets hungry and she makes a big stink about it, fusses and carrying on until somebody gets her something to eat. Kind of an interesting thought, I think. All she can eat is milk. Just a little milk. And they force her to burp. And when I burp at the table, people think I've done something terrible. But when she does it, it's so cute. Even if it smells really bad, that was just the cutest thing. And everybody's really proud when Molly burps. When Bill burps, not so much. And, oh, it's funny. She passes gas. And that's the cutest thing in the world. And again, people clap and cheer. Woo! That smells terrible. Wasn't that cute? Again, when I do it, nobody gets too excited about it. It's almost embarrassing, they say. But the worst thing in the world about babies is they can't take themselves to the bathroom. They poop in their pants. And it's terrible. It's a horrendous mess. And yet when it happens, Elaine jumps up, "I'll change her," like it's like she's won a prize. And she's talking to her about what a great job she did and how big of a mess she made and how bad it stinks. And she's, "This is great, Molly." And again, nobody wants to follow me in the bathroom. I don't understand it. So the point I'm making this morning is babies do things that adults aren't supposed to do. Babies can get away with things, and it's even kind of cute when they do it, that adults are not supposed to do, because we know better. We grow out of those things. And over the course of time, from 3 months on, she'll still be very dependent on us for a long time. But over the course of time, she will learn how to feed herself. She will learn how to take herself to the bathroom and all of these things that grow towards maturity. And that reminds me of a journey that we are on as Christians. We had several baptisms this month, and some of them younger children, and we think, and I've been processing all of this about, well, you know, this, we're really on a spiritual journey. I think about the way the Bible presents this, and you may have got a hint from the reading from Hebrews chapter 5, which we'll come back to in a little bit. But in John chapter 3, there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you're a teacher, come from God. No one could perform these miracles you're doing if it were not from him." Jesus replied, "Well, very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." "How can someone be born again when they're old?" Nicodemus asked. "Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born." Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and of the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit." So what you have here in the New Testament, beginning with Jesus, is an equation or a parallel being made. When one submits to Jesus, when one wants to be a member of the kingdom of God, when one wants to be a Christian, the concept is being born again. And we don't talk much about being born again in churches of Christ. I'm not sure why, because that's very biblical language. And I find this text peculiarly interesting because Nicodemus didn't ask about how to join the kingdom, how to be saved. Nicodemus just makes a statement. I perceive that you're really from God. You're truly a prophet, at least from God. And then Jesus talks about being born again. And then Nicodemus does query about, well, how is one born again? But Jesus never really answers that question. So it's really an awkward conversation without a lot of good answers that comes out of it. The point I want us to see this morning is that Jesus makes the case that becoming a Christian is being equated being born again. And the same thing that Paul mentions in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17. He says, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. So that's why I spent a few minutes talking about my granddaughter, beside the fact that she's so cute and we miss her, is the fact that it's a reminder to us that when we are born again, when we become Christians, we are starting over. We have a chance at a fresh slate, a clean start. However, what that also means is we may not have all of the answers at that point. And I think that's what I've come to reconcile in my own mind as we're baptizing children younger these days, is maybe that's a good thing. Maybe that's because in my generation and many of us, we thought that you had to know all the answers before you got saved, that you had to know a whole lot of scripture, that you had to understand the tenets and doctrines of Christianity and churchianity and how to do all of the churchy stuff just right, and then you could be saved. I'm afraid the New Testament presents this idea of being newborn, born again, as the moment when one comes to the realization that Jesus Christ is Messiah, that he is the Son of God, and that he's come to save the world. So more and more, we're hearing children who are being baptized. You know, my generation was, why do you want to be baptized? Because I don't want to go to hell. That's right. I'm asking these kids, why do you want to be baptized? Because I love Jesus. Because I want to follow Jesus. Because I want to do the right thing. And that's the right answer. So I think when you look at this in a different context, I think we're exactly on the right track here. But then we have to keep in mind now, you can't take a newborn babe, whether they're 8 or 58, and turn them loose. We don't do that with infants. Well, Molly, you're awful cute, but you're on your own. If you're hungry, go get something. Well, I'm sorry your diaper's a mess, but I'm not going to do anything about it. You figure out how to change it. We don't do that with human infants. But sometimes with spiritual infants, they mess their spiritual diapers, and we get all up in arms. And we forget that they're babes in Christ. They don't know all of the answers yet. And I think maybe sometimes the way preachers like myself have presented this is when you're saved, when you come up out of the waters of baptism, everything is perfect, and it's not. You're perfect through the blood of Jesus Christ, but you're still going to be struggling with temptation, with sin, with trials. You're not going to have all of the answers to all of the doctrinal questions and issues because you're on a journey. Baptism is the beginning of a journey, not the conclusion of a journey. Sometimes we get to that point where somebody's baptized and we celebrate and we should, but that's just the starting point of their journey with Jesus. Peter, in 1 Peter chapter 1, makes a couple of references to being born again. Chapter 1, verse 3, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of that salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. You are born again through a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus, the gospel, the death, burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. That's the starting point. When you understand that Jesus indeed is the one who did that, raised through God's power, and you're born into a new family, a new creation where there is hope and where there is optimism. A little bit further on in 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 22, Peter says, Now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth, so that you have sincere love for each other. The purification obviously is talking about baptism, I believe, a washing, a purifying, through obedience to the truth, so that you have sincere love for each other. Love one another deeply from the heart, for you've been born again, not of perishable seed, not of mortal flesh, not of humankind, but of imperishable, of spiritual, through the living and enduring word of God. So that's the journey that we begin when we're born again, when we become Christians. We're added to the kingdom. We become members of God's community. And we work together. We're on this journey. So that takes me back to a lot of this Old Testament stuff. Our Christian journey is kind of twisty. If you've been on this journey for a while, I think you can probably attest that you've been on some mountaintops. You've had some peaks. You've had some valleys. There may have been some times where you didn't even feel like you were making progress at all on your journey. You were stuck in a rut. You were stuck in the same place, and you wondered what was going on. And there were times on this journey when you really messed your spiritual diapers. I mean, you really got in a bad place, and you weren't sure how you were going to get cleaned up and get going again. That's normal. So I go back to Genesis chapter 12. And I think this is a metaphor or a parallel for our spiritual journey. Think about the calling of Abraham. In Genesis chapter 12, God called Abram from the land of Haran. And he said, through your seed, all of the nations of the earth are going to be blessed. So Abram at 75 years of age picks his entire family up from Haran, comes down to the promised land. The land of Canaan that we talk about. Well, he wasn't there very long at all, because also in Genesis chapter 12, a famine arose in that land, and next thing you know, they're down in Egypt. After a while in Egypt, they come back up to the promised land. And over the course of this time, you know, Abram's thinking about this promise. Through my seed, all of the nations of the earth will be blessed, and Abraham has no children. He was 75 years old when the journey started. His wife was 10 years younger, 65. He has no children. God says, through your children, and he has none. So finally, at about 86, he has a child. But it wasn't through Sarah, not the promise that he thought was being fulfilled. And God reassured him, it's going to be okay. It's going to be through Sarah. Sarah's going to have a child. So finally, at 99 or 100 years of age, the promise to Abraham is fulfilled. And Isaac is born. But you know, Abraham died before he ever saw the fulfillment of the promise. Isaac, he had some sons. He didn't see the promise fulfilled. Jacob, who became Israel, he had 12 sons. He didn't see the promise fulfilled. But Joseph, one of his sons, gets sold into slavery in Egypt by his own brothers. And you think this family, this God's family, may be falling apart because they were at each other's throats. Well, you find out in Genesis chapter 50 that when they're all reconciled, that Joseph realized, well, what you intended for harm, God meant for good. I was sold into slavery. I wound up in Egypt to save us. So all of Abraham's family and descendants now moved back to Egypt again, and there they stay, and they're prospering so well and multiplying so rapidly that they wind up slaves. And for 400 years, they're in slavery. So I bet this whole time they're thinking, what about this promise that God made to granddad or great-granddad or great-great-granddad? We've heard all about this, that God was going to bless us, but man, it doesn't seem like we're making much progress on our journey. And just when we seem like we're getting somewhere, we have a setback. So God sends Moses, the deliverer, to lead the people out of Egyptian bondage. And they're making progress, man. They cross the Red Sea on dry land. They come up right to the edge of the promised land, and they can see it. And the spies went and said, yes, it is great. The city's, it's perfect, except for one thing. The people are huge, and we can't do it. And they fall away again. God punishes them. They spend 40 years wandering around in the wilderness, camping here and there and walking along. And again, I bet you the whole time they're wondering, what's going on here? We thought we were the children of promise. We thought we were God's special people, and yet we can't seem to make it where we're trying to get to. And after 40 years of wandering, they finally cross the Jordan River, again on dry land. They go in and they conquer Jericho, a massive city, a fortified city, maybe one of the largest and strongest fortresses of their time. And they conquered it by marching around it 13 times. Craziest battle in the history of the world. The walls fell down flat, and they see God's power again. So they spend the next several years feeling like, maybe this is it. We are in the promised land. God is with us. We are God's people. And that went on again for a pretty good while until they forgot about God again. And he begins to send people, the Philistines and the Amalekites and the Ammonites and all kind of ites you can think of, give them a hard time. They prospered under the reign of David. Under Solomon, they were wealthy, and then they divided in half. They had a falling out among the older folks and the younger folks, or the new king and his followers and his dad's followers, however you want to look at that. And lo and behold, here we go. God's chosen people are having conflict. And then the Assyrians come and wreak havoc on the northern 10 tribes. And then Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians come and destroy God's city, Jerusalem, the temple where God's chosen people live. They're carried off into Babylonian captivity, where they stay for 70 years. And then they come back. And they come back to a land that's been decimated, devastated by the Babylonians, by others who had come in and taken occupancy now. You see where I'm going with this? This journey is not always straightforward. This journey is not always easy. Sometimes when we're journeying with the Father, towards the Father, towards eternity, we get stalled out. And we just end up camping in the same place for a long time. And then, like the children of Israel, they would cry out to God. The book of Judges is the prime example of this. After being sorely oppressed by one of their neighbors, after finding themselves destitute, hungry, broke, they would cry out to God, we're sorry, God, forgive us. And God would. God would raise up a deliverer who would come, and he would be with them, and they would vanquish their foes, and they would have a period of peace, and they would serve God with fervency. And then they would turn away. And the same thing under the period of the kings. They would go through these periods of time where they were faithful to God and they were worshiping God, and then they would fall away and God would send punishers, destroyers. And they would cry out to God for deliverance. He would raise up a deliverer, and then they would be back to God's favor. I don't know about you, but that sounds a whole lot like the journey I've been on for 49 years. Good days, bad days. Times when I knew that I was right in the palm of God's hand. Times when I knew that there was nothing that I couldn't do because God was walking beside me. But there have been times when I didn't want to get out of bed because I didn't know where God had gone to. I felt like he'd left me alone somewhere and left me out here hanging. And where are you, God? I thought we were on the same team. Turned out God was there, just like he was with the children of Israel. He was always there. It was them that moved. They're the ones that would turn away. They're the ones who would forget. They're the ones whose attentions and priorities would be turned to other gods, to other things. And that's what he continued to tell them. The Lord is full of mercy, compassion, slow to anger, full of grace. So that's the reminder for you on your spiritual journey and for me, wherever you find yourself. Because what I know after 15 years of preaching is this morning in this auditorium, in the auditorium at Central Valley, those who are watching on Facebook Live, there are people at different places on their journey. We've got some folks who are new babes in Christ who are ready to turn the world upside down and they're on fire. They're just waiting for, as David said, someone to pass the baton. Someone to pass the faith onto them, someone to take them by the hand and show them how to live, how to grow, what they need to be doing. There are folks on their spiritual journey who are nearing the end. That's what happens when you live long enough. I mean, that's the linear progression of things. We live, and there's a point when we stop living. We call that death. It's inevitable for every single one of us. So as we get closer to that, we got to be doing some examination and making sure we're ready to stand before God. And then there are those of us in the middle somewhere. Those of us in the middle who one day we were born again and we were new babes in Christ and we were excited and we were on fire and then life happened. Maybe the fire got a little bit cooler. It may have completely gone out for some of you. There may be some of you here this morning who came here because somebody drug you. You came to sit with family. You came because you're going out to dinner after this and you didn't want to have to just explain to everybody why you weren't there with the family. So you just came on. But in reality, your heart's not here. Your mind's not here. You're 1,000 miles away. Could care less about anything I've got to say. Most of us have been there. I promise you. You're not alone. God is still there. God is still waiting for you to reach out and take him by the hand to finish up this journey. He wants you to do this. There are folks who have been stalled out in the same spot for a long time. You grew spiritually, you were on fire, but then you just kind of became complacent. It's life. It's in every aspect of life. You know, there are times where you have stretches in your job where you just love it and can't imagine doing anything else. Then you may have a stretch of weeks, months, or maybe even a couple years where you're like, I wish I could do something else. That's the spiritual journey. There are times when you're on a workout program where you're making great headway. People are noticing you're losing weight, you're growing muscles, you're fitter, you feel better. But then something happens and you miss a day, you miss 2 days, you miss 5 days at the gym, you miss 10 days. You say, it's too much trouble to start over. I'll just give it up. Spiritual journey is the same way. People on fire, they come to church, they're involved, they're wanting to volunteer to do everything. Next thing you know, barely see them very often. Just kind of coasting, just kind of going through the motions. That's the journey. God didn't leave. God didn't change. God's still right where he always was, ready for you to come back. When you go back to 1 Peter, begin chapter 2 this time, therefore rid yourself of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. Like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk so that you may grow up in your salvation. It's amazing to watch a baby that's hungry. I mean, they're panicky because they can't do it. They don't know really what's going on, but they know you get that bottle in their mouth, and it's like, wow. They just can't get enough. They can't get it out of there fast enough. That's what Peter is telling the folks that he's writing to. Crave pure spiritual milk, just like you were a baby, because you need it to grow up and grow strong and healthy. Just like a baby can't grow without nutrition, A spiritual being cannot grow without spiritual nutrition. And spiritual nutrition is worship. Spiritual nutrition is Bible study and private meditation. It is service to others. It is fellowship. It is breaking bread. It is coming around the Lord's table every first day of the week. That's where we get our spiritual nutrition from. Now to Hebrews, the reading this morning, Hebrews chapter 5. The Hebrew writer is making some pretty profound teaching towards these Hebrews. There are some folks who have converted to Christianity and they've kind of gotten weak in their faith, their journey stalled out. They're even backtracking a little bit. They're going back towards Judaism because they're not understanding it all. So the Hebrew writer is trying to explain to them how the new covenant's better than the old covenant. The new law is better than the old law. The new high priest is better than the old high priest. The new sacrifice is better than the old sacrifice. And he comes to a point where he's talking about Jesus being that high priest. And you can almost sense frustration with him. Verse 11, he says, "We have much to say about this, but it's hard to make it clear to you because you no longer try to understand." They've given up. In fact, though, by this time, you ought to be teachers. By this time, you ought to be instructing others in the faith. By this time, you ought to be passing your baton on to someone else. He says, you still need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's word all over again. You have failed to continue and make progress on your journey. You're still back at Mount Sinai at the foot of the mountain waiting for God to do something, when God's already told you to move forward. He says, anyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness. But solid food is for the mature, who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. See, there will come a time that Molly will not be satisfied with a bottle of milk. It won't fill her up anymore. And she won't grow if we don't do something about it. Mix a little cereal in there. Then some baby food jars. Then some of them little baby Vianney sausages and little things like that so she can feed herself. And she'll grow. And then when she gets older, she'll eat real adult food. And she'll grow. That's the thing that we as Christians have to remember. You can't stay on milk. Solid food is for the mature who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. Fuel for the journey is a relationship with God, one that is nurtured, maintained, groomed, grown by continual Bible study, by continual worship with the saints, by continued service to God's people. We sang the song right before the lesson. We're marching to Zion. Beautiful, beautiful Zion. That's where we're headed, folks. We're headed to eternity with God the Father, where we will spend all of eternity with Him. There's nothing better. Absolutely nothing better than that. But don't get stalled on your journey. Wherever you find yourself this morning, I encourage you to re-examine it. And if you're stalled, acknowledge, hey, I'm stalled. I got to get going again. If you become complacent and other things have taken priority over this journey, realign your priorities. If you've not begun your journey, see, that's the thing about the little bit of a difference between being born again spiritually and physically is physically you have no choice. You're born, and then you have to do something about it. Spiritually, the choice is always yours. And interestingly enough, our journey to that point is different. I was fortunate, I was blessed to be raised in the church. I was born into the church, I was raised in the church. It was just a matter of, will he become a Christian at 12 or 13 or 14? You know, that was really the only challenge. Some folks didn't have that blessing or that luxury. You have to come to Jesus on your own. Somebody has invited you to be here this morning. Somebody that you've watched live their lives, and you say, I like the way they live. I think I want to check that out. If you need to put on Jesus this morning and become a part of His family and begin your journey, I would encourage you to think about that. The 4th of July, freedom. We celebrate freedom as a nation. On Sundays, we celebrate freedom in Christ. We celebrate freedom from the law, freedom from sin, and freedom from death. That's what it means to be a Christian. That's what happens in baptism, immersion. It's a new beginning. That's where you become a new creation. That's where you get the clean slate. That's where you become a babe in Christ. And then you begin to consume that milk and you grow thereby it. God bless you and have a great holiday weekend with your family. But I would love for you to get your spiritual house in order this morning. Don't leave here without at least giving it serious consideration.